Hello and welcome to Pete's Box of Stuff, a series in which I talk about stuff that I have in boxes, photographic stuff, of course. In the last video, I talked a bit about the advantages and disadvantages of macro tubes or extension tubes, as they are also called. Macro tubes, extension tubes are, well, tubes, right, that allow us to quote-unquote convert our already existing lenses into macro lenses. How do they do that? By making the minimum focusing distance smaller, so we can get closer to what we want to take photos of. In this video, I will not only show you a little comparison, right, how much macro do we really get with the help of a set of extension tubes. I will also show you some tips and tricks, how I work with mine, so maybe you can get something out of that. And just as if that weren't enough, I will also show you or talk about two other ways how to convert your already existing lenses into macro lenses, but why I still think that macro tubes, extension tubes, are the way to go. My name is Pete, I like pictures. Let's start. I mentioned it briefly in the first video that if you consider to get a set of extension tubes, get sure that they have electrical contacts. Why is that important? Only that way your camera will be able to communicate with the lens, and so only that way you will have autofocus, which is nice, but even more important than that is that you will be able to change the aperture of your lens. Lenses for digital cameras do not give you the possibility to change the aperture on the lens directly. That is only possible with vintage lenses like this M42 lens, right? And you will want to change the aperture for the simple reason that the aperture directly controls the depth of field. So the range of how much is in focus, and that is really the thing that you want to control in macro photography. How much macro do we really get out of a set of tubes? I made a little setup. I took a match, because a match is really small, right? And everyone knows how small or big a match is, and I glued it to the lid of a film container so I can put it on a desk and move it around. And what I did then was to take my 50mm 1.82, why, I will talk about that in a minute, and I attach it to my camera. And I used the minimum focusing of that lens, which is 0.45 meters, 45 centimeters, or 1.5 feet. And I took a photo. And then I attached the tubes. Well, we can stack them, right? Each tube will give us the possibility to get a bit closer. So I moved the match closer so that to that point where I was able to focus on that. And I took photos and I found the result pretty impressive. Why did I take a 50mm prime lens for this example? Very simple. Chances are that you already have one anyway, right? But even if not, 50mm prime lenses are usually the most affordable high quality lenses that you can get for every brand of camera. Like, this is still the old version of the Canon 50 1.82. The price range was at around 100 to 120 bucks. I think it's the same with the newer version. I even saw it on sale once for like 80 bucks. And then getting a set of tubes, this set was at around 20 bucks. So you'll get a fully functioning, high quality macro lens for between 100 and 140 bucks, which is unbeatable, and certainly a great way to get your toes wet in macro photography. When I ordered my extension tubes, I was really excited, because not only would they convert my already existing lenses into macro lenses, right, but they will also give my
telephoto lenses, a bit more punch in the telephoto direction. At least I thought so, because what I do, right, if I put the extension tubes between the camera and my lens, they add focal length, because that exactly is what focal length is. It's the distance of the focal point of the lens to the camera sensor. And so, yeah, they do. They add focal length, but it sadly doesn't work that way, because by adding these extension tubes, we will lose the ability to focus to infinity. Actually, the focusing range that we have now is really very, very shallow. So yes, you will get a really affordable macro lens, but sadly, it won't add to your telephoto abilities. Well, not to your telephoto abilities, to the telephoto abilities of your lenses. Our three best friends in macro photography, other than, of course, the macro lens itself, right, or the lens with the macro tubes, with the extension tubes, are number one, a tripod, number two, the camera's display, and if we have the swivel screen, comes in very handy. And number three, the depth of field preview button. I heard that many people don't even know that it exists, so what it is, we're going to talk about that in a minute. First of all, the tripod. I will not be talking too much about the tripod or tripods in this video, because the next video will be about tripods exclusively. I got a couple of questions concerning tripods, so we're going to talk about tripods in the next video of this series. Why would we want to have a tripod in macro photography? Well, very simple, because if we go very close, which we do in macro photography, it is sometimes very hard to avoid camera shake, because we want to close the aperture a lot sometimes, and we don't want to raise the ISO too much sometimes. Why would we want to close the aperture a lot? Because to get a decent depth of field with a very wide open aperture, we have a very, very shallow depth of field, which in some cases is not wanted. So we want to have a deeper depth of field, so we'll have to close the aperture. And if we don't want to raise the ISO too high to avoid noise and grain, we have to have comparatively long exposure times, and that is sometimes hard to hold hand with a free hand, right? And so we might consider a tripod, and there are even specialized tripods for macro photography. I'm going to talk about that in the next video. Next thing, the display, the swivel screen. That is probably one of the most useful things ever. When I got my Canon 700D, I read that it has a swivel screen, and I thought, yeah, nice to have, right? I don't need it. I look through the viewfinder. This is, by the way, not my camera. This is a 750D that I borrowed for making this video, so that I can show you a camera. But sometimes, especially in macro photography, it's hard to look through the viewfinder, because the small things that we want to take photos of are sometimes on places that are hard to reach. So a swivel screen, or a display in general, comes in really, really handy for that. Also, we can zoom in on the display to really get the focus correctly. Very, very useful. And that can only be done on the display. So the display and the swivel screen is probably your second best friend in macro photography. And now number three, the depth of field preview button. What is that? Every DSLR has a so-called depth of field preview button. On that camera, it's that little button directly under the lens release button. What is it good for? Well, we have to know that whenever we look through the viewfinder, or even when we look at the display, the camera will always show us the brightest possible picture, and therefore it will adjust the aperture to give us the brightest possible picture. If we are in aperture priority mode or in full manual mode, we can set the aperture. The aperture is directly responsible for the depth of field. But, well, for preview purposes through the viewfinder or on the display, the camera uses the appropriate aperture for the brightest possible picture, and only if we press the shutter button, the set aperture that we set in the camera in AV mode or in full manual mode will be used for the final photo. So we don't really have control over the depth of field by looking through the viewfinder or looking at the display, but well, again, depth of field preview button to the rescue. If we press that, then the aperture that we set will be, well, set in the lens, and so we can see the actual depth of field, which is really, really handy. It sounds very complicated, actually it isn't. Try it yourself. Put your camera to AV mode or, the aperture priority mode. I think with Nikon camera it's called A mode or the full manual mode. Set a desired aperture, play around, open the aperture really a lot, small number, and then close it. And look on the display or through the viewfinder, you won't see a difference. And only if you press the depth of field preview button, you will see how the set aperture will affect the depth of field. Last but not least, let me talk about two other ways how to convert your already existing lenses into macro lenses. One possibility is to get a so-called reverse mount or retro adapter. What these things do, and I can't show you because I don't have one, is to allow you to attach your lens the exact opposite way on your camera. Because apparently this also reduces the minimum focusing distance. The problem with these things is that they are comparatively pricey, and because you will have to attach one to the front part of your lens, it all depends on the filter diameter of your lens. So you might end up with more than one of these adapters if you have lenses with different filter diameters. The next problem is that, well, the front part of your lens doesn't have contacts, right? So your camera can't communicate with your lens. So these adapters consist of two adapter rings, basically. One also for the rear part of your lens, and then there are cables that are connected to the contacts in your camera. So that all looks pretty adventurous, also pretty cool, to be very honest, very nerdy and pretty cool. But I personally think, other than that they are comparatively pricey, I personally think that you're much better to go. Well, I will stick to my extension tubes because, well, it's much easier, right? A second possibility, and I can actually show you that, is to get a macro adapter lens, a lens filter, which also, of course, has to be screwed on the front part of your lens, so also uses the filter diameter of your lens, so you will end up also with probably more than one of these if you have different lenses with different filter diameters, or you have adapters for that, step rings for that, for them. The problem is that if you want to have a high quality one, they are really expensive. This is a really cheap one that I once got because I was just curious, right? And that alone cost more than double as much as this set of extension tubes. Plus, it has extreme vignetting, so darkened outer parts of the photo, and extreme chromatic aberrations plus distortions, which gives a nice effect. But if you really want to have high quality at low price, extension tubes are, at least in my personal view, the way to go. So this one's for today. Bye bye. Till next time.
I'm pretty sure you want to subscribe to this channel.
Why do you say that?
Because...